is the Rip and Read featuring Curtis Sliwa. Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Curtis Sliwa, your upcoming host on the Rip and Read. So, Curtis, as I believe your father was a merchant marine, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes, 54 years merchant seaman.
So you should have some insider knowledge, maybe some commentary to share on this potential longshoreman strike, this port strike that could paralyze port operations up and down the East Coast.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, a number of situations. First off, there's been a dispute about whether we should keep the Waterfront Commission or not. Your governor, half in the bag, has already been bought out by organized crime, and he says, hey, look, what can I say? I get free scotch. I get free cases of scotch. I don't want the Waterfront Commission to continue. And remember, the port of Newark and Elizabeth, one of the busiest ports in the world. Every day you have ships coming in and out, straight to the Verrazano, and then on their way to New Jersey. No more to Brooklyn. Those are the cruise liners, you know, Red Hook. But it used to be years ago. They'd be coming into Hoboken, Port of Newark, Elizabeth. Brooklyn, waterfront, Red Hook. I mean, Vibrant, along Manhattan. I mean, that was a time in the 50s where if the longshoremen went out on strike, you didn't cross the line. As my father would say, look, you think I want a hook in my back? I'm a member of the National Maritime Union. I'm a delegate. We respect each other's picket lines. But if you cross a longshoreman's picket line, there's a hell of a price to pay. Right out of one of the greatest movies of all time with Marlon Brando, remember?
Absolutely.
And On the Waterfront, which was filmed at the port in Hoboken, New Jersey.
Wait a minute, you. You take them heaters away from you and you're nothing, you know that?
You talk yourself in the river.
You take the good goods away and the kickbacks and a shakedown cabbage and a pistol arrows and you're nothing. Your guts is all in your wallet and your trigger finger, you know that?
You ratted on us, Terry.
From where you stand, maybe, but I'm standing over here now. I was ratting on myself all them years. I didn't even know it.
Come on!
You give it to Joey, you give it to Dogan, you give it to Charlie. It was one of your own. You think you're God Almighty, but you know what you are?
Come on!
You're a cheap, lousy, dirty, stinking mug. And I'm glad what I've done to you. You hear that? I'm glad what I've done. I'm going to keep on doing it
till I get... One of the greatest movies of all time. All about the waterfront. Exactly true. Now, my father would come in on the Brooklyn side of the waterfront. And the guy who controlled the longshoremen was Albert Anastasia. He'd have his sausage and pepper sandwich. He'd be wearing his guinea tea. And if you gave the longshoreman any beef or he didn't get his vig on, every cherry, every watermelon coming in to the port of Brooklyn, you'd end up with a hook in your back.
Hook in your back. Wow, that's rough.
Well, remember, that's what the stevedores would do in order to unload the cargo ships. They didn't have cargo containers back then. Everything was on a pallet. Everything had to be put up on a winch. You did not cross that picket line.
Mm.
If they went out on strike, there'd be a hell of a price to pay.
So are you suggesting that there's going to be people looking to cross the picket line now?
No, because everything is so civil now. Nobody honors each other's picket lines. You know, it's almost like a page from the past. But the crime at these ports continues. So now that we don't have a waterfront commission, you know, it's been pretty much disbanded, relegated, neutered. Boy, for every one cargo container coming in to the port of Newark, Elizabeth, another one comes in with red Chinese illegal aliens, you know, stowed away. Another one comes in with fentanyl, and another one ends up on a tractor trailer being brought out to parts unknown like a scene out of Goodfellas. Kabish, Kabish, you understand what I'm saying? You wasp, what would you know? The only thing you've ever done near water is hillbilly hand fishing.
Right. Or maybe some yachting or something like
that.
Yeah,
I noticed you have your shirt there. I see, oh, wow, Hillbillies for Vance. Getting ready for the debate?
Big debate tomorrow night. I'm excited.
Are you going to be here? They're going to have the huge Studio 17 devoted to debate watching.
Right.
You got the coach fresh from going to the University of Minnesota Gopher game.
Did you see that? He got people all upset because his motorcade was blocking traffic, making it difficult for people who were just going to that game, normal fans who were being impacted by that.
Yeah, but did you see him in the stands wearing the Gerald Ford leather helmet from Gerald Ford's days at the center for the University of Michigan? Did you see that?
I did not see that he was wearing that helmet.
Oh,
no.
My God, you missed it. I knew that was on Saturday Night Live, right? Oh, this, God, all of this happening simultaneously. This is better. This is better than sex. I want you to realize this.
I didn't realize you were such a Gerald Ford fan.
Well, I wasn't. But remember, they tried to kill him twice,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, you were the one who told us about that.
Squeaky Fromm first from the Manson family. And then, what was it, 47 days later, another woman who actually was a confidential informer for the FBI. Boy, we really need to get into that. I don't know if Frank Morano, The Other Side of Midnight, has done a deep dive on that. But I promise everybody out there, I will devote the best side of The Other Side of Midnight that I host Saturday mornings from 12 to 6 to the break of dawn, and then Sunday mornings where I don't permit anybody to go to sleep, and then you're stangard all day long. But, oh, it was apocalyptic. It was biblical. Did you see the waters just seething up in the hillbilly hills of North Carolina?
Yeah, crazy. I mean, basically, they're saying that for that region of North Carolina, that's like a 100 years flood, maybe 1,000 years flood.
Oh, so now everybody here, except for me and Anthony Weiner, back-to-back, belly-to-belly, we believe in global warming, climate change. But the rest of you, you laugh at us. What was it President Donald Trump said in Erie, Pennsylvania, right near Lake Erie? He said it's a hoax.
The whole man-made climate change thing. Yeah, it's a hoax. It's a hoax.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, what do you think that was, right?
A hurricane?
It was a hurricane, right?
Yeah.
But
we've never had those before.
You think Helen there was simply just a hurricane? Don't you think it was a message?
They say that these storms are getting much more powerful, much more frequent.
Why is that? You know, why are they getting more frequent? Why are they getting more powerful? Because the sea is warming up.
Mm.
Then the condensation goes up and it whips around.
Yeah. Well, and we've heard about for years El Nino, El Niño.
Superstorm Sandy.
Right.
I'm right again, right? It's attributed to global warming, climate change.
If you watch the fake news channels, yeah, they're going to tell you all about climate change.
Oh, so you're accusing me of being fake news, huh? What about when that Noah's Ark is completed in the hills of North Carolina? I'm hoping that we have our first animal that comes on to that Noah's Ark. Happy.
Oh, happy. You're going to get your book of a spot on the Ark?
Well, we have to look at what Happy's been through. What an ordeal.
I understand there's an update, by the way, concerning Happy.
Yes, there's an update. But first off, let me give credit where credit is due to Noam Layden. He's been the civil individual here who has done the deep dive and finally gotten the Brooklyn Zoo. That's right. I'm not calling you the Brooklyn Zoological Society. Get online and sue me. But the Brooklyn Zoo, he's gotten them to admit that Happy
Bronx Zoo, but yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Was kept in the Bing. You know, I mean, it was not permitted to go out.
He was blocked from being outside? He was detained.
For 10 weeks.
Wow. What did he do?
Solitary confinement.
Did he do something wrong?
Punk City, protective custody.
Why was Happy punished in this
way? Well, now we see there is photo imaging of Happy's legs, and there's rot on his toes and his nails, which leads to death of the elephants.
Oh, no.
And so last night on the Animal Welfare Hour, which you probably missed because you were too busy hillbilly hand fishing in the Raritan River, Nancy was describing all of this, that we put a plea out for a podiatrist who deals with elephant issues. Now, I mean, come on, there aren't that many, you know, in the white pages. I mean, you go looking for a podiatrist. By the way, who uses white pages anymore? That shows you how I dated myself.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Go looking for a podiatrist for elephant feet problems. So
I'm flipping through the yellow pages right now.
We came up with our own. Poor Happy's feet have cracked. You know, it's nails, and you know how big those nails are. Yeah. So first I was going to go to a Korean nail center, you know, where they do the nails, where give you the pedi and the mani.
Yep.
I couldn't recruit any of the Korean women. They say, you're crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So number two, I'm willing to go into the elephant pit there at the Bronx Zoo and with a vat of iodine. Because I don't know about you, when I was a kid and I'd get busted up, cut up, you know, I busted my head, I had my first stitches. My mom would put iodine on everything. I had red spots on my body. People thought that I had measles or something from the iodine stain that had been ingrained.
Yeah.
Iodine's the best.
Mm-hmm.
What do they do to you before they operate on you?
They use the iodine.
That's right. So why aren't we bathing? Why aren't we bathing Happy in iodine there? But oh no, the bronchological veterinarian says, oh, that would not work. Really? What have you done? So now I'm making a last offer before I threaten to kidnap Happy and take Happy to that sanctuary in Texas where he can roam free. 30 miles a day, elephants need to roam with their herd. Desinex
instead of iodine.
Well, if they won't accept that.
Right.
You're a jock, right? You played high school football.
Right.
What's the one thing that was in every trainer's room for the football team?
Yeah, for sure. Athlete's foot, right.
Because you go into the shower, and what would you catch? Athlete's foot, right? Because everybody else would say, all it takes is one athlete to come in there with athlete's foot, and then all of a sudden there's gangrene on everybody's
feet.
Well,
that's why I always like to use the flip-flops in the football shower.
Oh, man, that is so weak. Yeah, you probably like getting hit, you know, snapped with the towels, too, as you were running through the phalanx.
What are you trying to say?
Of the seniors. No, they would that would all be part of hazing, right? If you want freshman football, JV football, the seniors, right, they would be snapping those towels as you'd be running through.
How are you planning on, let's just say, the Desinex, the Lotrimin, the Tough Actin, Tenactin, that's not going to be accepted. How are you going to get Happy to Texas?
Well, no, this is first we got to put the Desinex. We get these huge jumbo athletic socks that are like the size of balloons.
Okay.
We put them around Happy's feet and we just load it up with Desinex. That's what my father used to do. He had athlete's foot. And that's all. He'd always wear white athletic socks. He'd load it up with Desinex. You know, that canister. It would be filled with Desinex. He'd put his feet in there, and he got rid of his athlete's foot and his ptomaine fungus that he had brought from third world countries because he sailed the world.
So you're not actually that worried that you're going to have to get Happy to Texas because you figured that the Desinex is going to work.
If they'll let me into the elephant pit. Now, remember, Happy is not all that happy. Happy is an angry elephant. So if I try to approach Happy with a canister of Desinex in my hand and a hefty trash bag to act as an athletic sock, easier said than done.
Yeah, there might be a splat, and I don't think we're thinking about the tube of Desinex.
Look, have I put myself on the line before?
You have.
Every day, what do I tell our owner-operator, John Katzimatidis? If I'm
wrong,
I'm gone. Have I squared off against the Gottis and organized crime, street gangs, you name it, crooked politicians? I wonder if there are more crooked politicians or more organized crime members. It's about neck and neck, Democrats and Republicans. I've done all of that.
Yeah, you're still here.
But I'm 70 years old. And in honor of St. Francis Assisi, I think it is time for me to get into that elephant pit. They're going to arrest me. They're going to say I'm trespassing. With a vat of Desinex in one arm, hefty trash bags in the other, and get it under the feet of Happy. It's going to be a little difficult to negotiate that. And then let it walk around for about a week with its feet in those hefty trash bags. And you'll see the Desinex powder just like emerging. It works. If you're not going to use iodine, then you got to use my dad's solution for athlete's foot and toe fungus. That is Desinex.
And you figure that the Guardian Angels school and the guide when it comes to various health ailments and all that outranks the Bronx Zoological Society.
Oh, come on. They're effete snobs. All they have is their tofu Perrier with a twist of lime at their fundraisers that they don't even do in the Bronx. They do on Park Avenue in Manhattan. Not Park Avenue in the Bronx or Park Avenue in Brooklyn. I need to do this for Happy.
All right.
If it's the last thing that I do in the world.
I just hope you get those logistics ready for getting him to Texas if you have to do it.
Meantime, why don't you get the hell out of here?
Curtis Sliwa. Rip and Reed. Check this out.
This is the Rip and Reed featuring Curtis Sliwa.
Talking about
now. To the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa. This is the Riff and Reed.
We don't get fooled again. No, no.
This is the anthem every time I talk about Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo. And I don't know if you saw over the weekend on the Fox News channel, I was on Jimmy Fallon, and gave the Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo salute. Andrew, ascendeme tu si provieros facim, and like your father you are. As he attempts his comeback like a zombie and a political vulture hovering around a drowning Eric Adams, unknown sources in the Jewish community have suddenly said, oh, he's our guy, man. He's our guy. He will save us. He is our goyim Mashiach.
He is saying it is time for the Shabbos goy. The Shabbos goy can do the work that benefits both the Jewish community and the non-Jewish community. The Shabbos goy can turn on the lights on the Sabbath. Because it benefits everyone. It is time to turn on the lights.
Yeah, well, I've turned on the lights on you because you are a fake, phony, fraudulent Fugazi who tries to reinvent himself. And no doubt, you know, with Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, he'll be out there hiding in the Hamptons. He'll go to a synagogue, a shul out there, you know, put the yarmulke on his head and profess that he wants to protect Jews. But you forget. This is the guy who did not allow any of our local and state officials to work with the group that keeps the enemies of Americans and Jews out of New York who want to put us in harm's way, and that is ICE.
New York State is the state that says we will not cooperate with ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. He politicized ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. We said we will sue them if they violate any criminal laws in the state of New York.
Did you hear that? He called ICE thugs. Never apologized. Ramzi Youssef was the mastermind of the first World Trade Center attack in 93 when he was caught in the Philippines and brought back and flown over the World Trade Center. The FBI guy said, why'd you choose the World Trade Center? And Ramzi said, because that's where most Jews would be. We could get them all in one shot. So he's out there in Colorado in the world's terrorist jail deep underneath in Florence, the Supermax, and he'll rot there and die. But then his cousin, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, took over, both Pakistanis, and went and sold the idea to Al-Qaeda's Osama bin Laden. He said, hey, we could hit it again because that's where most of the Jews are. So this time they were successful, and all of a sudden we developed ICE, L'Immigre, Immigration and Naturalization Service. Recently, 8 Tajiks of ISIS-K were caught coming across the border by ICE. We would not have been permitted to work with ICE in that regard. Some of them were on their way to Coney Island Avenue in Brooklyn because Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo made it the law you could not work with ICE.
New York State is the state that says we will not cooperate with ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. He politicized ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. We said we will sue them if they violate any criminal laws in the state of New York.
So ICE protects Jews and Americans from attack. And then lastly, did you see the ICE data? Tens of thousands of illegal immigrants who were allowed in are guilty of sexual assault, murder convictions, they're drug dealers, they're kidnappers. And who is it that has kept them at bay and reported to us? ICE. One last time for all of you Cuomo-sexuals out there who want to forgive Cuomo for all of his sins. This guy will aid and abet terrorism and thugs who are illegal aliens because he won't let ICE do their job.
New York State is the state that says we will not cooperate with ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. He politicized ICE. They're a bunch of thugs. We said we will sue them if they violate any criminal laws in the state of New York.
Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
Curtis doesn't know about you, but he rips and reads.
This is the Rip and Read.
Oh, it's another Sunday, and the refuge for every political rogue on a Sunday is a black church. Going back to Bill Clinton with the Monica Lewinsky mess. And then Bobby Menendez, who sold out America for gold bars and money from Egypt and Qatar. Always on a Sunday, they go to a black congregation. And now you got the gruesome twosome, Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo and Eric Adams, swagger man with no plan. In fact, it's almost like there are so many black churches in the five boroughs that they're going to have to carve up and somehow try to figure out, no, Eric, I'm going to this black church. No, Andrew, you can't go there because I'm scheduled there. Anyway, it is a refuge for rogue politicians and those who are seeking forgiveness so that they can resurrect their political careers. And that's exactly what Eric Adams is doing because he's trying to survive. And they gave him a bully pulpit up in the Bronx yesterday. After that, he went out to Staten Island. Today, he will be in Queens at a Latino church on Roosevelt Avenue. Oh, yeah. These guys are going to be hitting churches, you name it. If you got a church near you, expect that Eric Adams will be there, followed by Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo. This is what Eric Adams had to say yesterday as he said, I'm the man. I'm Black Jesus.
I have led this city since 2022 as your mayor. Not only have we decreased crime, not only have we taken thousands of illegal guns off our street, but we have transitioned people who lived in homeless shelters and moved them into permanent housing in 1 and 2 years more than anyone in the history of the city. We have brought back more jobs in New York than the history of the city. Our children have outpaced the state in reading and math. We have cut black and brown unemployment by close to 30%. We put more money into women and minority-owned businesses. We made our subway system safer. The number of crimes in our subway system for the last 8 months have decreased, and we have the lowest number of robberies on our subway system in the history of our subway system. Tourism is back. The city has recovered through COVID, and 217,000 migrants and asylum seekers, unlike other cities, we have done it the Christian way, where you don't see no family or child sleeping on the streets of the city of New York, because that's what Christians are supposed to do.
So now that Eric Adams and Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo are going to go to black churches throughout the five boroughs, Justin, can we suggest that there be a fact checker? You know, like Trump, they were all over him in that ABC debate against Harris. Could we have a fact checker in order to contradict all the lies that both of these guys tell? But Eric Adams has been renewed with religiosity.
I am more in Bach, and I am more found in my foundation of my faith than I've ever been in my life.
Hell yeah, he's got to. That's the only constituents he has left. And he's also playing the black card, the race card. But he goes back to the motherland in Africa.
The pastor pointed out that, yes, I'm a Christian. But we should never be lost in the fact that although I am called an American, I am African. I am African.
Oh, they were up on their feet. They were up on their feet. You see, he hit all three. He hit, I'm a churchgoer, I'm black, but I'm really from the motherland. I'm African and a Christian, too, man. It's sort of like he scored the trifecta, the troika, the trinity. And then, who knew that he goes to church every weekend? I had no idea, Justin Ellick. I mean, I got rats in the Eric Adams administration. Some were part of his police detail from One Police Plaza who let me know everything he does. I got to be straight up honest with you, unless it is a political event that he goes to a church for and the cameras and the media are always there. He never goes on his own. But there it was. He told a lie like all politicians do in church, and I'm surprised God did not strike him dead where he stood at that bully pulpit.
As I walked into the church today, one of the reporters stopped me and said that, why have you spent so much time this weekend going to churches? They just don't know me. Every weekend I go to church.
Wait. Club Zero Bond till the break of dawn. Concifrito in the Bronx till the break of dawn. And then there's Casa Cipriani till the break of dawn and other clubs. How the hell does he get any time to go to church? The only thing he's interested in is in God we trust, like all politicians, Democrats, Republicans. Give me your money, and I will pretend that I go to church on every Sunday. And when they're in trouble, they certainly do. Let's look at the rogues gallery that always seek refuge in a black church. First, there was Bill Clinton on the Monica Lewinsky situation. Then Bobby Menendez, first church he went to in 2016 when he was first indicted. Black churches throughout Trenton. And then, of course, now you got the gruesome twosome, Andrew Evil Eyes Cuomo and Eric Adams, Swagger Man with No Plan, fighting to be able to show black people that they're more religious than the other guy. Oh, my God. But then there's that angry side. Don't mess with Eric Adams, because if you mess with his blackness, you're going to get accused of being a racist.
People can say what they want. There are those in society that still long to see me stop saying Kunta Kinte, and they want me to say Toby. And it's uncomfortable for them. So you can whip me as much as you want, but when you take off my shirt, you'll see the scars are already dire. You know, I've gotten beaten enough that I can't be beaten again. I came into government saying Kunta Kinte. I'm leaving government saying Kunta Kinte. And if you don't know who he is, go see Roots.
Drops the mic like a rapper. To be honest, you know, look, I ran against him. I have been reporting on him. I've been letting you know ahead of the curve everything that's coming down now. People are saying, oh, you knew, you and your wife Nancy knew, do the deep dive. Yeah. But I don't ever remember him saying he was Kunta Kinte and proud that he was Kunta Kinte when he was running for office, when he came into office. Never once mentioned that. But man, he is playing that serious black card now, that race card. He's got the trifecta now. I'm a Christian, I'm African-American, but more importantly, you can trace my roots to the motherland, Africa. And now he's got tactical air support coming to his defense. Who's the number one African-American in America now? Used to be Marcus Garvey years ago. There were other black leaders. Then it was Martin Luther King Jr. There were other black leaders. They were jostled, but everyone recognized it was Martin Luther King Jr. Then it was Jesse Jackson, and Al Slim Shady Sharpton took out Jesse Jackson by planting a story in Jet and Ebony magazine that he had a gumada, he had a child out of wedlock, and Jesse Jackson resigned from Operation Breadbasket, the Rainbow Coalition, only to come back 3 days later and realize, yo, This was done by Al Slim Shady Sharpton to run me out so he can become the black leader in America. You see, no other group has a leader. No other group. You can't say white people have a leader. You can't say Jewish people have a leader. You can't say Latinos, Latinas, they have a leader. No other group is represented by one person. But the white media, the mainstream media, always seems to have to anoint one black leader for all black people. They are not permitted to think diversely, to have different leaders who may not even be of their own color. Oh, and God forbid they follow in the footsteps of Trump. They are race traitors. They are sellouts. They are Oreo cookies. They are double-stuffed Oreo cookies. So who rose to throw a lifeline out to Eric Adams? Well, it was Al Slim Shady Sharpton of the National Action Hate Network on 145th Street, who had developed not just Eric Adams, but Alvin Bragg. Yeah, those were two of his disciples. And he wasn't going to let you all of a sudden get rid of Eric Adams. I mean, that's his direct access. That's his easy pass to City Hall, like he had the easy pass to the White House with Barack Obama and obviously with Joe Biden. This is what he had to say. He warned everybody off. You better leave Eric Adams alone.
He should not be judged by anything but the trial. He should not be removed. They didn't remove Senator Menendez. They let him perform. But we're clearly not calling on them to be removed. By what standard? We've seen other people indicted. They were not removed. And that would send a signal that maybe this is more political than it is dealing with the merits of the case, which we've not determined one way or another.
That is a good argument. Look, Bobby Menendez remained the senior senator of New Jersey to the junior senator. He'll always be junior, even if he becomes a senior senator, Cory Booker. He had to give up being the head of the Foreign Relations Committee, but he remained in the Senate until he was found guilty, and then he resigned his position. He's making a good point there. And it also caused the comeback of President Donald Trump, who used to be part of the Three Amigos in Atlantic City when he had the casinos. They were inseparable at the time. There was Al Slim Shady Sharpton. There was Donald Trump. And, of course, there was It's Great to Be an American, Don King, who's apparently suffering from Alzheimer's and dementia now somewhere in Florida. I'm not quite sure. But Donald Trump threw Eric Adams a lifeline by saying, yeah, I knew this was going to happen by Biden and Harris. I knew this over a year ago.
I will say this. I watched about a year ago when he talked about how the illegal migrants are hurting our city and the federal government should pay us and we shouldn't have to take them. And I said, you know what? He'll be indicted within a year. And I was exactly right.
So he's got the support of Al Slim Shady Sharpton, who is hosting a black summit to make sure they don't take this righteous black brother down and commit a double standard. This is really aimed at Kathy Hochul. You better not touch this brother or else there's a political price to pay, Kathy. Stay in your box. And then, of course, who summed it up at the end of his holy roller session in the Bronx yesterday before he went to a holy roller session in Staten Island last night and a holy roller session before a Latino crowd on Roosevelt Avenue later on today? It was Al Slim Shady Sharpton who said that God determined that he would be a mayor at this moment in time.
God placed me in this moment and placed in my heart to continue to move this city forward. And so you hear the small number of loud people saying, well, he should step down. No, I'm going to step up. I'm going to step up. I'm going to step up. I'm not going to resign. I'm going to reign.
He's going to reign. And that doesn't mean purple rain like Prince. R-E-I-G-N. That's what a king would say. I'm going to reign. This battle continues, ladies and gentlemen. Let me simply say, I hate Eric Adams. He made my life personally rough. But others have done that along the way. His minions try to get me fired here at WABC on a regular basis. Luckily, management and ownership here determined that, hey, if you're wrong, Curtis, you're gone. That was my agreement with them and John Katsimatidis. If I'm wrong, I'm gone. So it was high noon every day for me. But I will tell you this. We cannot throw Eric Adams under the bus. He's a crook. Imagine him. He's a pickpocket. He's picking our pockets. But Jumaane Williams will destroy the city. Oh, it'll only be 3 months, 2 months. No, no, no. No, he's not a place sitter. They're going for broke to socialists. They want to control not just the city council, not just the control and public advocate spot. They want total control with the mayoralty. So hold your nose. Hope that Eric Adams survives, because if he's out, then Jumaane Williams and destruction of our city is in.
Talking about this is the Rip and Read featuring Curtis Sliwa. Now to the Bernard McGurk Studios of 77 WABC and Curtis Sliwa.
We're on the eve of destruction.
The eastern world, it is exploding. Violence flaring, bullets loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war.
Barry McGuire, great song. And, you know, it's interesting. This past Friday, finally, we were able to get rid of the dictators, tyrants, despots out of the General Assembly. They packed their bags. They flew home with their diplomatic pouches stuffed with Molly, ecstasy, cocaine, drugs galore, illegal contraband, because that's what you can do with a diplomatic pouch. No one's able to search it. And they're out of here. And we kept them all safe and secure. We can't seem to do that with President Trump. He's going back to Butler, same place that he was almost killed. But Bibi Netanyahu got on that stage, one of the final people to speak. And delegations got up from Lebanon to Saudi Arabia, other Middle Eastern Persian countries. They left Turkey, although they had to run down and post a bond for the best friend that Turkey ever had, Eric Adams, down at Pearl Street in the Southern District Court. But, boy, he gave fire and brimstone. Bibi Netanyahu, seen out of Godfather, where he basically told the Iranians and the Ayatollahs that he was settling all scores.
I have a message for the tyrants of Tehran. If you strike us, we will strike you. There is no place. There is no place in Iran that the long arm of Israel cannot reach.
Now, immediately, the Iranian authorities in Tehran moved the Ayatollah out of his residence to parts unknown, because they understood they had just taken out the Hamas number two guy, actually number one at that time, who was in the guest house of the Ayatollah, after they had installed a brand new Iranian president. So they knew that BB and Mossad and Shin Bet and the IDF don't play around. But Nasrallah, he didn't see hiding. He started giving a speech to his followers of Hezbollah. Listen to him mention Netanyahu.
وانا اقول لنتنياهو ولجالنت ولجيش العدو ولكيان العدو لن تستطيعوا أن تعيدوا سكان الشمال إلى الشمال. لن تستطيعوا أن تعيدوا المستوطنين المحتلين.
And then while he was giving his speech, all of a sudden the bombs were falling as the Israeli jets were flying overhead, dropping 2,000-pound bombs on his compound halfway through his speech. I mean, now, is that a tough guy or is that a tough guy? The Ayatollah was immediately whisked out to safety because the Iranians in Tehran, they knew the Israelis would take him out. But Nasrallah, could I hear a little bit of Nasrallah first? He was the tough guy, right? Listen how he talks right to Netanyahu.
وأنا أقول لنتنياهو ولجالنت ولجيش العدو ولكيان العدو لن تستطيعوا أن تعيدوا
And then the bomb started falling and dropping. Halfway through his speech, you could see it on Al Jazeera TV. It went blank. It went dark. And then I heard a voice. It was like as if Chucky had emerged. You know, we're on the verge of Halloween. You remember all the Chucky movies, don't you? It's almost as if Chucky had inhabited the mindset of BB. And it was a warning to all of Israel's enemies in the Arab-speaking, Farsi-speaking world of the Persian Gulf in the Middle East. In the words of Chucky.
This is it, world. From now on, no more Mr. Good Guy.
No more Mr. Good Guy. So the Israeli Defense Forces are mounted up at the border. This was a border that was ceded over to Hezbollah and Lebanon years ago by Ehud Barak. There was a coalition of Syrian Maronite Christians along with the IDF, that kept a 10-mile barrier. Overnight, Ehud Barak pulled the IDF out, never alerted the Syrian Maronite Christians, and many of them were slaughtered as a result. They will never forgive Israel. Every time I'm on Atlantic Avenue or in Bay Ridge, they come up to me, why do you support Israel? They left us out there to be slaughtered. Well, guess what? Vengeance will be quick and swift. This is a scene right out of The Godfather. Bibi is settling all scores. Hezbollah is on the run. The Ayatollah is hiding, fearful that he too will be next. And maybe this can lead to the destruction of Iran that is oppressive to so many people in the world.